Well, good evening, everyone, and welcome to this Festival of Ideas event on the state of the environment. My name is Maxine McKew. I'm your chair this evening. And a special welcome to Festival Director Fiona Stanley. And Fiona, well done for the extraordinary creative energy that you and your team have put into this festival. I know it's been a fabulous start. I would also like to acknowledge the Wurundjeri people of the Kulin Nations as the traditional custodians of the land on which we meet. Well, tonight's discussion, ladies and gentlemen, is meant to be as participative as possible. The Twitter hashtag is UOMFOI. We are keen to get direct questions, really, as opposed to comments throughout the discussion when our panellists start talking in a little while. And I'm going to call on Liam Cage-Brown, who's down in the front row. He's going to feed some of those Twitter questions onto the panel. Well, to introduce the topic tonight, Victoria's Commissioner for Sustainability and the Environment, as many of you will know, will release her Commission's five-year report at the end of October, the end of this month, this year. But sadly, a critical family illness that occurred only at the beginning of this week has prevented Professor Kate Auty from joining us tonight. However, we are very fortunate and very pleased that into the breach has stepped Rob Gell. Rob, of course, is a celebrated environment scientist, geographer and communicator, and he's going to give us the keynote presentation tonight on the state of Victoria's environment in the context of global developments and reflect on the journey that the state of Victoria has made from the last State of the Environment report in 2008 right up until now. Then we'll move into our discussion and we'll be joined by Amanda McKenzie, Shelley Penn and Professor David Karoly. But first, by way of background, Rob Gell is an environmental and communications consultant and director of the Beehive Group and Whirlwind Proprietary Limited. Rob is a coastal geomorphologist by training. He began his career as an academic teaching environmental science and physical geography at Melbourne State College and at the University of Melbourne. Then for more than 30 years, he told us what the weather was on commercial television. He's also an adjunct associate professor, collaborative research network at the University of Ballarat, chair of the UNESCO Western Port Biosphere and Wildlife Victoria, and is a member for the Victorian Coastal Council. So would you please welcome Rob Gell. Thank you.
Thanks, Maxine. Thank you very much, Maxine. And I do have a very croaky throat, but I'm over what I had. And I'm very much enjoying the opportunity to be here and present some things to you tonight. I'm going to provide a very brief overview, introduction to, well, indeed, the state of our environment. It's not the environment. We are very much part of our environment. And I think we lose sight of that sometimes. I'm going to make some general points. I'll work out how to work this in a minute, go through some of my own experiences in the process and some of my observations as well, and establish really a context for our panel. I love to use this slide sometimes. It's a file you can download from the NASA website. It's about 98 megabytes, but it really does give us that lovely sense of what astronauts perhaps once appreciated about our planet. And it's from here I want to move on. We are in a period, this is about the only reference you'll get to doing the weather on the telly tonight, but we are, and I use this slide because we are currently in a period of extraordinarily rapid change. We are going through a technological revolution with mobile phones and all the things around that, the likes of which we really haven't seen on the planet before. But things are changing in our natural world equally fast at the sort of time spans that we need to be concerned about change. So as a geographer, physical geographer, we think about two fundamental concepts, and they're both very difficult to think about. The first is distance. Contemplate, if you will, the distance between a neutron and an electron, and compare that distance with the 150 million kilometres between here and the sun. These are very difficult things for us to get our head around. The other fundamentally difficult concept to think about is time. compare this period of time we'll spend together this evening with the 13.8 billion years that it's taken for our planet to form, or the 450 million years old for life to climb out of the oceans onto the land. These are very difficult things for us to think about. So if we look at this timescale, we can see, and if you've been watching Ian Stewart on The Rise of the Continents, you'll be full bottle on all this stuff. 450 million years ago, the supercontinent Pangaea broke up and formed Gondwanaland. About 100 million years ago, Australia and New Zealand took off northwards and left Antarctica to closer to where they are today. Some arguments say that it's been more recent than that, that Australia separated from Antarctica. Then we come right up to the bottom right-hand corner of this chart, to the little bit that we're occupying now, and in particular, the last 10,000 years that we call the Holocene. This is a very, very stable climatic period in Earth's history, and it's fundamentally allowed our civilizations to evolve the way we know them today. Cultivation and all of the things that we take for granted today. But it's a very, very brief period in history. The other point I want to make is you need to go right back to down here to where we knocked off the dinosaurs. And that was a really interesting period. That was the last time perhaps the climate was changing as rapidly as it is today. Something very big hit the planet, took us into a deep freeze very quickly, and then we warmed very quickly straight after that. So we've seen a lot of changes on our planet, but right now we're seeing some very rapid changes as well. Now I want to take you to my days at university back in the early 70s as a science student at Melbourne University. These were the things that were concerning us at that time. Rachel Carson's Silent Spring had been written in the 60s. Garrett Hardin had written The Tragedy of the Commons. Paul Ehrlich was writing about population. And all of these issues were brand new. And indeed, it's part of the reason why I took up an interest in environmental matters, because this stuff was so new, it was coming onto our reading lists at the time. It was all brand new stuff and very, very exciting. Interestingly, the greenhouse effect you'll see there. I did a course in second year botany with Tom Niels, and we studied the prospect of climate change under the greenhouse effect in 1972. Interesting enough, and I remember making the comment, because some of you in the audience will remember that in 1972 we had quite a big thunderstorm through the city and a big flood down Elizabeth Street. And there were Volkswagens being washed down Elizabeth Street and things like that. And we actually made the comments in our classes back then, boy, if this keeps up and if that's what thing we can expect with seeing climate change, the Melbourne Metropolitan Border Works are going to have to increase the size of their pipes. Now that was in 1972, but it's one of those things that you remember. So I guess back then, state of the environment, well, we were saying, well, it might be a bit of a problem, but we don't really know at this stage. But it's pretty interesting. Let's see what we can find out. Let's skip ahead. The first national state of the environment report was in 1996. Ian Lowe, now the president of the Australian Conservation Foundation, was the chair of the State of Environment Committee. This report, in fact, identified that Australia has some very serious environmental problems and they need to be dealt with immediately. Immediately. But in his little foreword in the front of this quite large document, because it was the first time this work had been attempted to international standards, and I believe some hundreds of Australian scientists contributed to it, Ian's comment was, "Our lack of knowledge emerges time and time again in the report as a major obstacle to sound environmental management." And there's that comment there, I forgot to bring it up. So serious problems, deal with them immediately, and we don't know enough to make any real assessments. There was an update to the State of the Environment report in 2006. And in that document, it says it's still not possible to give a comprehensive national picture of the state of Australia's environment because we lack accurate, nationally consistent environmental data. And this is a common theme. Victoria then embarked in and produced in 2007 a State of the Environment report. Ian McPhail ran that process. Very interesting time, of course, 2007. And this is in Ian's forward, he notes that at this time, very much opposing global events going on. Global financial crisis or global financial meltdown, call it whatever you like, against understanding of climate change. So a very short-term problem against one with very long-term costs. These are the key points that Ian pointed to in his opening. Most areas of Victoria are highly stressed. Our legislation, 30 acts and or thereabouts, holding the line at best were the words that he used, but probably delivering incremental loss. Government decision-making isn't always helping, so there's a range of government decisions that are in fact exacerbating the problems. And government needs to understand this fundamental issue that natural systems are the basis for our economy. I'm one of those that subscribes to the view that our environment is a wholly owned, that our economy is a wholly owned subsidiary of our environment. We need to understand that too. He also identified behavioural change as a very big task, and that our future well-being depends upon that behavioural change. If we look at the little list, I don't know how quick, easily you can read them, these are the topics that we looked at: land and biodiversity, climate's changing, we must act now, consumption as a major issue, coasts and the sea, land and biodiversity. Good news, maybe we're doing some positive things with air quality in Victoria, and the ozone hole is getting smaller, but it's going to take another couple of centuries to fix it right up. At the end of, this document, there are then 286 recommendations of things we need to do. At this date, I'm actually not sure how many of them have been acted, if any, but there are 286 recommendations. Kate Auty's process is fundamentally different, and I've been a part of that process to a limited extent, but I've thoroughly enjoyed it. I just want to reference this particular document that Kate and her team produced: Many Publics, Participation, Inventiveness and Change. And it really responds to Kate's desire to strongly engage with the community right across the state. And through 2011, Kate and her team did lots and lots of interviews with people right across the state on their reflections on the state of the environment process, communications on science, and she developed a really deep understanding of the feelings of people who really, across our state, have an active understanding of a whole range of issues. Indeed, it is a shame that Kate can't be with us tonight. I've heard her speak about this on a couple of occasions, and she speaks with really deep emotion and heartfelt understanding of what the people in the state are both understanding and going through. So there are words like this in the document, and she talks about the capability of people and the real understanding. Perhaps I'm putting this up because of my career in the media, because the media doesn't. We've got a fundamental gap in the capacity of our media to understand this stuff. It's like, you know, sometimes I say to people, this is not simple like economics, this is really hard stuff. And it's very difficult for the media, in many cases, to understand, particularly science, but to get together these complex interactions that are going on around our environment and be able to express them so that people can be genuinely engaged. So this is a very, very useful piece of work, and we're very much looking forward to Kate's State of the Environment report when it comes later this year. I'm going to come back to this document, which I use sometimes in presentations, but it's a useful tool for me to introduce the topics that our panel will look at tonight. And it's a special report from Time magazine in June last year, following the third Earth Summit. The first Earth Summit was 1992 in Rio, was at 10 years later in Johannesburg, which didn't achieve a whole lot. I'm not sure that any of them have achieved a whole lot. But they're looking at a range of issues run by the United Nations Summit on Sustainable Development. And this particular article from Time magazine looks at the 10 big issues, the top 10. And I'm just going to quickly go through them so that we can note what they are. Deforestation, and this photograph, of course, of a rainforest in Brazil. Brazil's actually doing a bit about loss of rainforest and a major issue being cleared for farmland. In recent years, the loss of forest has been the lowest that it's been, probably since the late 80s. But there are still some considerable global threats, particularly in places like Indonesia, rainforest still being cleared for palm oil and things like that. Deforestation and degradation also produces about 10% of the world's carbon emissions, so there's a link to climate change here too. And of course, rainforests, not only the things that we haven't ever discovered, but there's a lot of endangered species that are at risk as we continue to clear rainforests. The second major point, and interestingly, this was one that Paul Ehrlich, I mentioned before, in The Population Bomb, wrote about when I was an undergrad. Currently, we're adding a Los Angeles worth of people to our planet every 3 weeks. It's a staggering number. And I'm going to quote Tom Hartman here. Some of you will know a wonderful book that he wrote called The Last Hours of Ancient Sunlight. And he says, We've created an overcrowded world of overtaxed resources by consuming ancient sunlight, converting it into temporary foods and consuming those foods to create more human flesh. This is something we really have to fundamentally understand. If you read Jeff Sachs' lovely book, Commonwealth, he says there are two things we need to do for the benefit of mankind going forward. And I hate using that. I shouldn't have said going forward. That's a, he says, many of you know why. We have to do two things. We have to stabilise the climate and stabilise the human population. And they'll both be very difficult to do. We are the most numerous mammalian species on the planet. We consume more than 40% of the world's total net primary productivity, the sum of all the food and energy available to all the other species on the planet. We consume more than 50% of the planet's available fresh water. And linked to this is just the consumption of materials. One of the staggering numbers that I always remember is in the decade to 2000, the United States put enough aluminium into landfill to rebuild the entire commercial airline fleet 25 times over. Now, if you understand that aluminium is liquid electricity, you understand why we've got a climate problem. It's the consumption of materials in this false economy that we have, which is about plundering resources and calling it growth. We're just plundering planetary resources and calling it growth, and it's not right. I'll make another comment about that a little bit later. We now have 7 billion people on the planet. We're on track to get to 9 billion by 2050, and this is an issue that's really fundamentally off the agenda. People like Roger Short will talk about it, but it's really not one that's dealt with. I had an opportunity as former chair of Greening Australia to meet with Tony Burke, who is the Minister for Sustainable Population, or Minister for Population, or was in Australia. And going to a meeting with him, there was some wonderful work done looking at what is a sustainable population, just for our continent. There's a range of views on that. Archbishop Pell reckons there's 50 million, it's a pretty good number, and some will say it's only 8 million. But the comment that Tony Burke made as we sat down to a discussion was, let me get this straight with all of you, we're not discussing a number, we're talking about spread. So they were not concerned with determining what was a sustainable number of people to live on the continent of Australia. I think the problem's too hard. The third point put here is endangered species, and this is not going to surprise anybody. I guess in some ways we've made some steps forward with endangered species, particularly in the richer nations. But tell it to the tigers in Siberia, or bluefin tuna in the Mediterranean, or rhinoceros in East Africa or Central Africa. We still have some major issues to deal with some critically endangered species. And interestingly enough, up until about the first decade of the new millennium, ecologists and biologists set targets for rebuilding biodiversity across the planet. And I forget how many there were, but they met, I think, in about 2011 or thereabouts, I think. And they went back and looked at the achievements that they'd made, having set those 10-year targets, and came to the conclusion that they had achieved none. So we're really not dealing with biodiversity and loss of species particularly well. This one, of course, I'll deal with a little bit more, given the context of this evening and our panellists. We're still sticking about 6 billion tonnes of carbon back into the atmosphere annually. We've ticked over 400 parts per million, which was a bit of a milestone. It's a fundamentally difficult problem, a wicked problem, as it's been described, and the potential to utterly change our planet for the worse. 2012, one of the warmest years on record, and emissions continue to rise. We'll come back to climate change. World hunger. A little bit of progress has been made, I suppose, in the 20 years up to Rio last year. But famine is increasingly a threat to the poorest nations of the world. And some of the fast-growing nations who are moving up the food chain as well. But about 925 million people still go hungry around the world, and the vast majority of those in sub-Saharan Africa or India. The challenge is to feed the world, and by 2050, we're going to need to produce about twice as much food as we're producing currently to feed 9 billion people. We're not too worried about water in Australia at present. We seem to, well, we're not in this state anyway. They're certainly worried in Queensland. We haven't had to worry about it for 2 or 3 years in Victoria after our great drought, our decadal drought. But this is still a fundamental problem globally. There are more mobile phones in the world than there are toilets today. One in nine people in the world lacks access to an improved water source. And the issues there are preventable disease and reduced agricultural yield. And climate change, of course, is exacerbating this problem as well. There is enough water to go around if we're careful with it, even with a growing population. Global poverty is a linking issue, the single biggest contributor to ill health and to an extent environmental destruction around the world is poverty. It drives the destruction of forests and other wildlife habitats. Global poverty has declined over the last 20 years because China and India have lifted up, but there's still many nations have been left behind. Here's one linked to climate change, and it's renewable energy. Sustainable development, and that's what you're discussing at an Earth Summit, sustainable development needs renewable energy. We don't have enough, in particular wind and solar. But renewables are growing very quickly. Most Australians are unaware that Germany today, 20% of its energy comes from renewables, 20%. This is what we're told fundamentally by parliamentarians both sides, that renewable energy won't generate baseload power. That's wrong. South Australia is running at about 50% wind power on some days as well. In fact, Germany on weekends runs at 50% renewables. And the developments in renewables, particularly in storage of renewable energy, is really moving very, very fast in this technological age. And the way, of course, being led by United States, interestingly, and China, but Germany in particular, who are planning to be 100% renewable energy by 2050. So they set, you know, big stretch targets, and they're just phasing out all the nuclear energy as well. So it depends what your perspective is. If you want to go for broke and really try and achieve something, it's interesting, but perhaps the Germans are a bit like that. I remember in 2004, we had a greenhouse conference at Fed Square. Steve Brax was the premier, John Thwaites was the minister, and we had a guy by the name of, let me get it, Peter Fischer, German. He was writing policy for Germany on climate. Steve Brax opened the conference and John Thwaites spoke. As Peter Fischer got up to speak as the keynote, Steve Brax and John Thwaites left, which I don't think Peter Fischer enjoyed all that much. I took him to the footy that night and he made the comment. But he opened up with it, he had his speech notes rolled up in his hand because I think he was a bit offended, frankly. And he said, you know the difference between Germany and Australia? He said, in 1987, after the Villach Agreement in Austria, acknowledging the potential for climate change, Germany said, look at that thing over there on the wall. It's got two wheels and a frame and a handlebar and a bell and a seat. That looks like a bike. And we got on it and we rode it. He said, Australia's saying, that's not a bike. And that was his view of where we were in 2004. We really hadn't understood. And of course, at that time, Germany was already making hundreds of billions a year in clean tech developments. Number nine is the oceans. And of course, this photograph is taken of the Shenneng-1, a Chinese registered bulk carrier grounded on the Great Barrier Reef Marine Park just a couple of years ago. Oceans get left behind a bit in the process as well, but they are in a deplorable state, not least because they've become 30% more acidic over recent years because of acidification through dissolved carbon dioxide. We do need to protect them, and the best way to do it is marine reserves. The best way to do it is marine reserves. And Victoria, fortunately, has led the way in this country on that. Air pollution is number 10, a silent, invisible killer, but it certainly takes a major toll around the world. According to the World Health Organization, more than 1.3 billion people die from outdoor air pollution every year. So, and this is linked to climate change as well. So not only can we reduce pollution, reduce climate change, we can save people's lives by cleaning up the skies. Now, United States and Japan have made a pretty good job at this, but this is still a real problem in China, but they're doing something about it as well. And the burning of coal is one of the major problems, and also cement manufacture. The question I ask, though, is that list not very similar to my list from the early 70s as an undergraduate? And the point that I would make, if we're thinking about the state of our environment, is that the issues that I learned about as an undergrad in the early 70s are fundamentally worse today than they were then, with the possible exception of destruction of the Earth's ozone layer, which we thought then was going to be destroyed by supersonic transports like Concorde, turned out to be something else, and we may have put some things in place to deal with it. But we really have done nothing as a species to protect what fundamentally supports us. Let's then look at this wonderful piece of work. This is some work done by Johan Rockström and a group of about 31 collaborators, in which they presented a new approach to measuring global sustainability on nine, what they call, interlinked planetary boundaries, within which the human species can operate safely. So they created what they call their safe operating distance and looked at the boundaries for each of these nine variables, so that if we stay, with the proposition being that if we stay within those boundaries, we can avoid major human-induced environmental changes on a global scale. And the suggestion being that if we go beyond those boundaries, we may reach some tipping points which are fundamentally destructive, from which we know we might not be able to recover. And the point that they made, though, is that we've already crossed three of those nine planetary boundaries, and those are in climate change, the nitrogen cycle, and biodiversity loss, and well off scale globally in biodiversity scale, in biodiversity loss. So the danger is that by crossing these thresholds, that we could trigger some non-linear, abrupt environmental changes that we don't really know enough about. I want to quickly look at biodiversity in our state, because biodiversity is the thing that gets left behind. We've been a bit, well, we were focused on climate change. I'm not quite sure how focused we're focused on climate change. I'm hopeful that the IPCC report released on just this last weekend might refocus us. This is a map of ecological vegetation classes in Victoria. So it's pre-1750, before white fellas turned up. Places being managed by Wurundjeri people here and a whole range of numbers of the Kulin Nation. These are whole ecosystems. They're not species, they're whole ecosystems. Now you'll pick out the Little Desert. There's the Grampians. This is the box iron bark of the Goldfields. The Otways Forest. Interesting, the South Gippsland Forest, identical. Watch that in just a moment. Alpine grasslands, the coastal plains, Crow-Jingalong National Park. This is the same map today. There's no doubt why we have a biodiversity problem in this state. In fact, we have the first worst record of biodiversity loss of any state in the Commonwealth of Australia. You notice that big bit of green there, gone. A bunch of Scots turned up in the South Gippsland Hills in the middle 1800s and said, gee, look at these great big trees, just like the Otways Forest. They said it must be really good for growing things. Turns out it's really good for growing great big trees. But they cut them all down. It's simply a reflection of how we've managed the land. I'm not blaming anybody, but that's what we need to understand, that we need to fundamentally reinvest in biodiversity in the state. The reason is, and I came to it before, that our economy is a subsidiary of our environment. Biodiversity provides us with ecosystem services. And I mean, for example, the free carbon dioxide recycling service that's going on for us in this room, the treatment of human waste in our oceans, the pollination of our crops, clean water from our skies. These are free services that nature provides for nothing. When Robert Hill was the federal minister, he agreed with an international valuation of ecosystem services globally at $47 trillion per annum. So if we had to pay for the stuff that nature provides, we wouldn't have any money left over for, you know, nice laptop computers and plasma TVs and stuff like that. So we've got to understand that nature has a huge value to us, and it fundamentally underpins our economy. Let's talk about the scale of the change and come back to my points about time and distance as a geographer. And this is a really nice piece of work. Some of the same scientists are working on safe operating distance involved in this, like Will Steffen, one of our former climate commissioners, but now one of our climate councillors, talking about a new epoch for Earth, but basically saying that humans have become a force of nature, reshaping the planet on a geological scale, but at faster than geological speed. And in particular, we're talking about the carbon cycle, and global warming is a part of that, the nitrogen cycle, which we've just mentioned. And scientists are now saying that we actually need a new name for the period of time that we're in now. And rather than calling it the Holocene that I mentioned earlier, a particularly stable period that began about 10,000 years ago, geologists are saying we now need to call this new epoch the Anthropocene, the Age of Man. We come now to, just now, and this is just a bit of a lead-in to for our panellists, and this fifth iteration of the Intergovernmental Panel Climate Change's work. Most extraordinary bit of work. This is heavy going, this stuff. This is really heavy going. But this, and I haven't had a chance to read all of this document. I've read bits and pieces as much as you can in the period of time available. So I do have a lot of faith in other people who have been through it. There are some changes from the version that was produced, the fourth assessment report that was produced in 2007. But, you know, by and large for the layman, and I'm really including myself, I'm sort of a semi-knowledgeable layman, there's really not a, you know, the messages are the same. And I've taken, because I don't want to take any of David Karoly's thunder from our panel, but I've taken these 16 points from Climate Progress as just a general heads up on what it's about. The first point is, yep, it's true, and it's because of us. Second point, we're as certain about it as that cigarettes can kill us and that the planet's about 13.8 billion years old in terms of scientific certainty. And I reckon we're pretty certain about a couple of those things. The warmest 30 years since 1983, and these have been the warmest years in the last 1,400 years. These have been the warmest 30 years in the last 1,400 years. There hasn't been a pause. The nine warmest years are since 1998. Our oceans are 30% more acidic. We are rapidly reducing the chance of keeping to this mythical number that scientists have been telling us for decades. Please don't go beyond plus two. Don't go beyond plus two. We're above 0.8 now. Because there's a lag, and David will talk more about this perhaps, because there's already CO2 in the atmosphere, there's a lag effect. Even if we went to zero emissions today, we're going to add another 1.6 degrees whether we like it or not. So we're getting close to, we're getting up around 2 degrees locked in already, and the dangerous stuff comes after that. Seas are rising and warming. The other point that's made is there's nothing wrong with the document. It's been probably the most checked document ever written, and the warming is probably as fast now or faster than it was 65 million years ago when the dinosaurs were knocked out when something very big and fast moving hit the planet. And those are the things we need to really concentrate on. There's some lovely work done by the now defunct Climate Commission, but if you want it, I've got it. Ask me for it. Ask anybody for it. It's out there. It's wonderful work. I've put this in just to remind myself to say, I would like to see, as we get towards some ideas, I would like to see an environment minister, any environment minister, screaming from the rooftops to Australians, demonstrating an understanding of the potential impacts on the Australian continent of dangerous climate change, and imploring Australians, along with the rest of the world, to be energy efficient, reduce pollution, promote renewable energy, advocate investment in biodiversity rather than finding an economic excuse why we can't. I cannot find an environmental minister in recent history in this country who's been a champion for our environment. And I think that's deplorable. Now, whether we need, as a community, need to support our environment ministers or give them the courage to do so, but I think that's what we need to do, because I think that's where we do need some leadership. Well, I think we might get to that in the panel discussions. Here's some bright ideas. I was involved in this. This is the Housing Industry Association. The builders will say, oh, look, $6 too expensive. I was involved in this process with the Building Designers Association of Victoria over 2011 or 12. We had 43 designs of 10-star houses. These are three-bedroom, two-garage houses and some apartments as well. These houses are so well insulated, they don't even need solar panels, but they certainly don't need air conditioning. In fact, the houses like these that are 8 or 9 stars with solar panels actually are making about $2,500 a year in revenue for the owners. We build the least efficient houses in the world. Our average housing stock in this country rates about 2 stars of our existing housing stock. and double glazing costs a fortune. Go to California and try and buy single glazing. You can't get it. They don't make it. Average housing stock in the United States existing is about 6.5 stars. Average housing stock in the EU existing is 7.5 stars. But we built this rubbish and continued to do it and say, oh, it's too expensive. But we actually don't understand the operational cost of these houses. So this tells us it can be done. We're doing it, but where's the incentive for people to live in buildings like this? I love this little story, and this is a bit of a prompt for Shelley as well. This is the roof of a dance studio in London, the Laban Dance Theatre. Through most of the EU, if you build a commercial building with a flat roof, it is compulsory to make it green on top. 25% energy savings, and you get to clean your rainwater and collect it as well. You're insulating your roof naturally. And in this particular case, on the Laban Dance Centre in London, they've actually created habitat for an endangered species. Now this is not rocket science, this is just a bit of, oh, what could we do? We could do this. Now we're starting to do green roofs, green walls and some cool stuff in Australia and around Melbourne as well. But there's really no incentive for us to do this. We're still sort of locked into a belief that we can profligately use electricity from burning brown coal, so-called cheap brown coal, because it's not cheap brown coal, because the costs are externalised to the atmosphere. What about some great ideas? I've just got a couple that I want to finish up with. This is a map produced by Worley Parsons, big engineering company. And they call Australia the solar belt buckle of the world. There's a comment made at a greenhouse conference a couple of years ago. We had, it was called 4 degrees, contemplating that we will go to +4 degrees if we manage to achieve all of the targets set by the nations of the world at the climate talks in Cancun a few years ago. 4 years is catastrophic. But one of the keynote speakers from Germany brought with him had an anecdote from a German industrialist who was making solar panels, who'd come to Australia to see what we were doing in the solar industry. Of course, we all hung our heads in shame. But he told the story, and this guy was saying, oh, look, I've been all around your country. And he said, Germany's a leader in the world in solar, along with China. We have, you know, half our country is covered with snow and ice out of the year, but we're still a leader. He said, I've been all around your country, and let me say that the worst site for solar in all of Australia is the west coast of Tasmania. However, this is better than anything we have in Germany. Now, Australia led the world in solar technology when I was an undergrad in the early 70s. Now it's led by China and Germany. And we're blaming the Chinese. The Chinese are moving so fast in this space, it's ridiculous. Germany has about as much sunshine as Alaska. And they're world leaders in solar. So why can't we be world leaders again in solar? I don't think it's probably too late. We can be collaborative and partner up with smart countries doing this sort of stuff. There's been some wonderful work done, roadmap 2050 in the EU, about how do we share renewable energy around, how do we reduce our use by 50% so we only have to replace 50% of it with renewables. Zero Carbon Britain got similar sorts of target, our own Beyond Zero Emissions group here in Melbourne with the university, looking at how do we wean ourselves off coal. Wouldn't it be lovely to actually see something like this adopted by a government? How do we, and to bring the community along to wanting to do this. The BZE targets, I think it's $8 per person, and we can get to zero emissions in Australia. Now, there's all sorts of work being done on this, but we've actually got to set ourselves the stretch goals to do it. Just a couple of days ago, Sir David King, the former chief scientist in the UK, together with Lord Richard Layard, putting up a proposal on the back of the IPCC report just released. Let's see if we can build up solar panels in the UK to manage this problem. So a chief scientist, a couple of scientists getting out with parliamentarians saying, let's set some targets and let's see what we can do. We need to have compulsory green roofs. on all our flat top commercial buildings. We need to use, for example, you know, double glazing needs to be mandatory in new buildings. Low energy cement needs to be mandatory in buildings. We need to do fundamentally different things with LEDs. All this technology is available to us. We could be stripping, I mean, the, you know, our 5% emissions reduction target by 2020 is almost in the, it's in the noise. It's not even measurable. I mean, you know, perhaps we could even adopt a target that Andrew Peacock had in 1990. Anyone know what that is? Leader of the Liberal Party in 1990 in opposition actually had an emissions reduction target. Do you know what it was? 20% reduction by 2000. 20% reduction by the year 2000. And I confirmed it with him personally. Because they responded, precautionary approach to the Villach Agreement in Austria in 1987. This is what we should be doing. And all of the emissions were coming out of government behaviours. So maybe we could even go to a useful target, something like that. And the other thing, of course, we must do is fundamentally reinvest in biodiversity. And this wonderful work led by Pavan Sukhdev, The Economics of Ecosystems and Biodiversity, shows us that as a global community, particularly the corporate sector, we have to understand the value of reinvesting in biodiversity for the sake of our economy. And at some stage, it would be nice just to have a little bit of discussion about the unreality of a perpetual growth economy. We might come to that another time as well. At some stage, the music stops, folks. We can't keep digging up stuff and selling it. At some stage, the music stops. The economic system is fundamentally flawed. I mean, at Monash University, geologists will talk to you about peak iron ore in 2050, peak gas in 2040. We've already reached peak land, peak fish, peak water, peak people. And we need to understand that resources are not infinite. And that's the way our economic system is running currently. So just to conclude, this is always valuable because these kind of people really get it together. They really reinforce to us what we need to understand. And we get this all the time. We got it through the global financial crisis. Oh, we've got to do something about climate change. No. We've just melted the economy. We've got to do something about that. And of course, they found $2 trillion in 2 weeks to prop up Wall Street. $2 trillion in 2 weeks to prop up Wall Street. So as a corollary, I like to use this little cartoon as well, which is what we're told. Economists tell us we can't afford to do anything about our environment because we can't afford it. Well, frankly, I'm not sure that they're running the economy particularly well, demonstrably. And this is an even better one. I actually got an original of this in my office, and I love it. And this is the person at the speaker at offering a festival of ideas. And the cynic responds, "What if it's a big hoax and we create a better world for nothing?" They're all good things to do. Thank you very much.
Rob, thank you very much. I mean, that was a thoughtful and a very sobering report card. And could I ask you to thank Rob again, because he stepped into the breach only about 24 hours ago, and I think he's given us an extraordinary presentation today. Well, just as stimulating are our three panellists, I'm going to invite them to come up onto the stage. First of all, Amanda McKenzie. Now, it's very interesting. Amanda's had to change her CV very quickly in the last 10 days or so. Up until very recently she was working at the Climate Commission. Well, she got a phone call from Greg Hunt, or certainly the organisation did, and that job doesn't exist anymore. But interestingly, Amanda is now setting up the new Australian Climate Council as an independent replacement to the Commission, a bit of innovation there. And already, I think, something like $800,000 has been raised for that through crowdfunding, an extraordinary achievement. So Amanda, would you come up and join us? Thank you. Professor David Karoly wears many hats. He is Professor of Atmospheric Science in the School of Earth Sciences at the University of Melbourne. He's also an internationally recognised expert on climate change and climate variability, including greenhouse gas change, stratospheric ozone depletion, and interannual climate variations. Equally, he is a member, he, as I said, wears many hats, but one of them, he's been a member of the Climate Change Authority, also expected not to exist for very much longer. David, could you please come up onto the stage? Thank you. and an expert in the built environment, and I know someone who will have a lot to say about some of the latter points that we were just hearing about, Shelley Penn. Shelley is an award-winning Melbourne-based architect whose work has been published and exhibited both nationally and internationally. She's been the Associate Victorian Government Architect up until 2010, and also the Design Director in the Office of the New South Wales Government Architecture's Office. So please welcome Shelley. I'm going to ask each one of our panellists, if you would, just to give us a reflection on what you heard from Rob. Perhaps, Shelley, would you like to start off? Well, I was just thinking that those marvellous green roofs we saw there, this is your shtick. So some reflections on what you've heard and perhaps some other comments.
Sure. Actually, I've gone through a cycle listening to you, Rob, of devastation and had to sort of think I've got to get myself together before I come and speak because it's pretty devastating news. We know it's not news. We've known it for a while. But through to hope, I think 20% renewable energy in Germany is fantastic. And then, of course, action. It's not a new kind of paradigm, that sort of little cycle, but that's something that I went through in my thinking. And I did write lots of notes. I probably have to rely on them. Thinking about the 10-star houses, that's right, they are achievable, way beyond achievable. I think we can also get a lot more out of places than 10 stars. Our rating tools are actually pretty crude at the moment, and we make places that are sustainable environmentally. That's critically important. We need to demand more, but they're not necessarily sustainable in a broader sense that I think is also important, and I might elaborate on that more later. I think one of the interesting things about those new houses is the need to retrofit. I mean, and that's a really important part of sustainability as well. Stop demolishing and rebuilding, wasting what's already there, but look at the stock that we've gotten and retrofit. And that's also part of limiting urban sprawl and so on, being more compact and efficient, which has a huge impact on the use of the resource, the land that we're on. So that's another aspect that I think we need to tackle in terms of the scenarios. Green roofs, fantastic, they are growing. And, you know, in a real sense, they're wonderful, and there's sort of not many things you can say against them. I think I just wanted to, if I can, just bounce a couple of thoughts. I think one of the other things that Rob said about, you know, we knew stuff in the 70s that it's still relevant, why are we here still talking about it? The same is true in, you know, my field in architecture. Architects were trained in passive design really forever and have been doing that for a long time. And the problem is there's only a few of us who are making, say, houses. Architects design a very small percentage of the houses that are being built. I'm not making an ad for architects to design every house out there. I'm making a sort of a call for much more sophisticated and complex, more sophisticated solutions to complex problems. And that's what sustainability is about for me as well. I think also another thing that really struck me from the beginning of Rob's talk was that great big gap between abstract concepts and the extreme other end of that, which is the real reductivism and simplicity of the media prism, the print media and radio that we have, and of politicisation and polarisation of issues that makes them so simple that we can't do anything with them. So that extreme gap is a real problem, and I guess I feel that's where the hope also comes in, and optimism that's coming from in terms of the media, the fact that social media is so powerful and so evident, and that organisations like Amanda's can take off. I think we have to grab those, and I guess that in terms of politics, the same is true, that we can use that to make our voices heard as the people. And I think that more than ever is incredibly powerful now, and it just reiterates for me the fact that we have personal responsibility that we have to pick up and take, and that's by engaging in that media, engaging in those conversations, basically making the Fairfaxes and so on obsolete because they're really not relevant to the much more complex and sophisticated discussions that people want to have and that we need to get really good solutions. And I guess that's a big picture stuff that's way beyond my field, but it's particularly true of the built environment. In the built environment, it has a huge impact on carbon emissions and on climate change. It's a massive impact. there's equally a huge scope within what we do in the built environment to change, and that's a great cause for optimism. But it won't happen if it's always limited by those sort of narrow prisms of media and polarising views. Public transport or roads? Well, probably both, but let's do them well. What order should we do them in? What's the priority? We need to be able to have those discussions to make better things happen. I've sort of gone on for too long, haven't I? But really, maybe I'll just sort of say that and then not say anything else.
We'll come back to some of those. Amanda.
I was listening to Rob's talk and it reminded me of a speech that I gave to a group of school kids in suburban Sydney not that long ago. And I asked the group who's been camping in the last year, and about sort of 20% of them put up their hand. And then I asked how many of you have been to the beach in the last year. Probably 3/4 put up their hand. But at least 1/4 of that classroom probably hadn't had much of an experience of the environment in the last year. And it got me thinking about how a lot of us don't have the experience of the environment in our cultural universe. The cultural universe of most Australians and most people around the world is dominated by other things. And our cultural universe is what helps define our values. So if you're watching reality TV shows every night, if you're watching Breaking Bad and a range of other popular TV shows, if you start going through some of those popular TV shows, whether it's Mad Men and other things, start thinking, what is the moral universe of our culture? There's a lot of mistrust, there's a lot of consumption, there's a lot of individuality. But solving environmental problems means there needs to be a lot of trust, there needs to be a lot of taking of responsibility, a lot of care for others and the environment around us, and there needs to be a lot of collective action. So I think that there's a real challenge for us in how we shift the cultural discourse. So I think we need to sell the environment, if you like. I think there's a lot of the environment movement, as well as organisations surrounding the environment, scientists, others. We do a lot of putting out reports, and a lot of that is based on complexity. A lot of it is dry language. A lot of it reflects the uncertainty. Two of the examples you had up there was, we don't know this and we don't know that. What the public is looking for is, what do you know? And how can you say it? It doesn't have to be simple, but it has to be simple. It has to be distilling those ideas into something that's really relevant to their day-to-day life. And it can't just be about the policy dynamic and the science. It has to be, what does this mean for me? And how do you make it relevant for me? So I think that we need to sell to people why because everyone cares about the environment to some extent, but we need to remind people of why they care. Coke doesn't just say once to us, you should buy Coke. Coke tells us all the time, you should buy Coke. And it actually doesn't say you should buy Coke. It says Coke is about having fun, and Coke is about you being part of this crowd, which is really cool and awesome. Why couldn't we say the same thing about the environment? Why isn't caring about the environment not the thing that's cool and awesome, and therefore we should protect it? And so just as a final point, I thought that the other thing that sort of struck me about Rob's talk, there's a lot that hasn't happened. But there is a lot that has happened. And I think the last few years are really demonstrative of that. If we look since 2004, there's been a doubling every year of investment in renewable energy. The last few years, you mentioned China. China's really taken off in terms of renewable energy, but they're also taking climate change very seriously in terms of emission reductions. They've just started putting in place emissions trading schemes that will cover 250 million people. And that'll be a real game changer worldwide in terms of carbon pricing. So I think there is a lot happening. There's a lot to change. And essentially, it goes to the competing ideas that are out there. So there's an idea that the economy is opposed to the environment, and the idea that the economy is fundamentally, and not just the economy, but all of us, and all of our society is dependent on the environment. So those are some thoughts.
Mm. Terrific. Terrific. Thank you so much. And David, if I can come to you, reflections on Rob and perhaps a few other thoughts as well.
Sure. I mean, Rob covered a massive amount of material in his presentation, and very effectively, so thank you, Rob, for that. One of the areas that struck me, and I think it's one of the things I've heard you say before, that maybe follows on from what Amanda was talking about, was this concept of the environment is critically important. And it's not that the environment is critically important to the economy. The economy is subsidiary to the environment. We cannot have an economy without an effective, functioning environment. And it's the value of the environmental services that dominate. And then when we look at this range of, if you like, environmental degradation that we've seen and that will be reported very effectively by the Commissioner's report when it comes out in October. We'll look at the state of the environment in Victoria. It will have some good messages, but they will be dominated, perhaps, by many other messages that talk about the impacts that we've seen in the environment over the last 5 years since the last report. And the other aspect that will then follow is, in some sense, the cognitive dissonance, the differences between the policies to improve the environment, this environment of ours that is so critically important for the economy, and the much stronger policy factors that are there apparently to drive the economy. And in particular, I'm reminded of the policy that was removed by our current state government on greenhouse gas emission reductions, which was done so because our federal government had a target. The only problem was the federal government's target was 5% emission reduction and the state government's was 20% emission reduction, consistent with, as you said, the earlier Liberal Party policy from the 1990s. That was phased out, and at exactly the same time, the state government put additional incentives for mining brown coal and exporting it to a market which is rapidly collapsing because there's an oversupply of fossil fuels, and governments around the world have decided it's a wasted investment. They're not going to be buying this product that Victoria is trying to sell. It's a bit like selling sand to the Arabs or coal to people who don't want it anymore. It just doesn't make sense. So it's a classic example of cognitive dissonance. Yes, we're going to solve climate change by relying on the federal government, and that doesn't make sense. And we're going to make money selling a product that no one wants to buy and its value is rapidly falling. Neither does that make sense, and both of those are new policies by the state government. It doesn't make a lot of sense.
I've got to ask a quick question here, Rob, because you raised this. Clearly the inspired person who got an Andrew Peacock's here?
Well, Chris Pupillik was his shadow environment minister, yeah. And Chris had done a lot of really valuable work in Antarctica that I'm familiar with. Mm-hmm. And Chris really had a good handle on a lot of good stuff, yeah. And was in touch with scientists and could speak the language and could converse well with scientists. And clearly, in opposition, they wanted something that they could go to, Liberal Party supporters, but also to the rest of the community and say, we're progressive. In the sense, because it was great to be green in those days. Still was, I think. And the point that I've made to lots of Libs since, when I've been asked to go and speak with, Liberal Party functions and stuff, and I said, what happened to you guys? When you think about it, the Australian Conservation Foundation was founded by the Duke of Edinburgh and Paul Hasluck. Mm. I mean, this is arts conservatism.
Conservatism.
That's right. And this is Liberal heartland. This stuff.
It was.
And they lost it.
It raises the point, because Rob, what was so sobering about what you said, you talked about being an undergraduate in the 70s, all these issues were out there, and you're really saying 2013, really, what's the progress been? You're not at all optimistic about what's come out of the big global gatherings. It represents an extraordinary failure of public policy, doesn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, when you track it, what...
We have great capability. Yeah. If you look at what's happened in the United States since the presidential election, the Republican rump, which is now investing massively in making truckloads of money out of renewable energy technologies, is saying to the Tea Party, will you guys please go and suck it, go away, because you're alienating our traditional voter base. We're making money out of this stuff now. So there's some fundamental changes. So, and I think that probably, and it's what's happening in Germany as well, and I think, and the same in China, where we've now got the people have said, we've got the biggest middle class in the world, we actually do want to breathe clean air. So there's a bit of pushback coming, and I don't think it's happened like that in China before, but it's happening, and they're responding, and they've got the technologies. But they set themselves, I don't know why we don't set ourselves some smart targets. We're really good at some stuff. I mean, there's a city called Shenzhen. I think it's about 18 million people in Shenzhen. And in Shenzhen, in 2006 or thereabouts, the mayor of Shenzhen said all new residential housing up to about 14 floors must be 100% solar powered for heating and electricity. No you know, no ifs or buts. And if you don't do it, $65,000 US fine. Guess what they make in Shenzhen? Solar panels and double glazing. So they create the market. It's just smart business. And I just don't know why we don't get that.
Well, okay, except
can I come to you on this question?
Sure, absolutely. And in fact, maybe we should go to Amanda, but I'm going to talk about something that the former Climate Commission reported earlier this year, and that is the wonderful success of uptake by the average mums and dads around Australia in putting solar panels on their roofs. Because in 2007, there were very, very few solar panels producing electricity on the roofs of homes in Australia. And I think the number was less than 10,000 homes. And the projections were that by 2020, 13 years in the future, there might be somewhere between 100,000 and 500,000 homes 15 years into the future. And what did we do in 2012? We already had 1 million homes with solar panels on the roofs. It was cheaper, it was faster, and the uptake just demonstrated that actually average mums and dads are really keen, first of all, to make money by selling electricity back to the electricity companies. They had their own production systems, their electricity systems on their roofs. They can make money out of it. Most of us still like to cut our electricity bills and then, if possible, sell some back to the supplier. The other thing that's happened, and it's really important, is there is, a purchasing response or a price response as the price goes up. Electricity demand in Australia has dramatically fallen in the last 3 years. So Australia's greenhouse gas emissions from electricity production have dramatically fallen.
So you can change behaviour.
We can change behaviour easily, and it's already been demonstrated.
I want to come out to the audience very soon. Do we bring the house lights up for that? But Liam, who's down here following our Twitter feed, Liam, have you got any questions for us at this stage? I'm going to get a microphone to you. Can we bring a microphone down here,
one
thanks?
One coming here.
Okay.
Comment? Yep. I know you're right, people do want to save money and so on, but I actually think people want more than that. And I think solar panels is an interesting one because with all of these things, there's the stick and there's the carrot, as we know, and the regulations are critical, and the fact that we ask for 6-star with our houses, which we do now, means that we are double glazing things that was radical not very long ago, and now it's standard in new buildings. It makes a huge difference to energy use and so on. Yep. But also things like solar panels are really important because they were a sign, and this point was made earlier today, and it's been made many times, that they're a sign of your beliefs. So stick them on your roof, they're very obvious, and they say, I care about the environment, I'm trying to do something to be more careful with resources, limited resources. But that comes up, I'm interested in why we've got this incredible knowledge, great sophistication, incredible intelligence and innovation. Why are we not doing it?
Can I just ask you, you're an architect, what does your average run-of-the-mill builder think of all this?
I can't speak for all builders, but They move with what's happening. So, I mean, if you're doing double glazing, the first few will sort of, God, that's expensive, do you really want to do that? Well, we have to, okay, fair enough. Then it's just normal. And then, well, you've got to double glaze. It's flow. I mean, that's why I find it frustrating that we do subsidise unsustainable, you know, resources and so on, because we know industry is smart and it will come along. If you regulate, you know, everyone's just ready to go. Just cut out petrol. Look, I was in Bangladesh in February. They've banned plastic bags. There's not a plastic bag in sight. That's a country with all sorts of issues and problems and concerns. We're not having plastic bags because they completely stuff up our environment. We rely on water, flooding, plastic bags block the flows and so on. It's a major drama. We'll ban them. Why can't we do that? They've got a whole lot of other stuff to do. I know, but it's
possible. Maxine, just a quick comment about solar panels for 30 seconds. The other part of it is it's actually become a disruptive technology because it actually disrupted the networks. The energy transmitters now don't know how much energy to send from Latrobe back to the city. So it's actually changing all of the economics of the whole game, and I find that fascinating.
Liam, where's Liam gone to?
Just here.
Right, okay.
Yeah. So we've had all of you talk about problems with public policy under the status quo, and we've had a number of Twitter questions on this theme. Twitter user David Brewster asked the panel, "The challenges are so immense and seem insurmountable. What has to give before voters actually care?"
Who wants to take that? Do you want to take that?
I'll take that. With the Climate Commission, we've spent the last more than 2 years travelling around Australia, talking to different communities, and talking to people from all walks of life. We talk to nurses, emergency services workers. We'll talk to manufacturing workers, all over the place. And consistently, people do care. And I think that this comes through in public polling as well, that people are concerned, they do care about the environment when they're asked about it. Sure, that will fluctuate depending on their circumstances or depending on what's the political flavour of the day as to where it rates on like a list of top 10. But consistently, I think people do care and people are concerned. I think what's happened in the last few years is there's been a very toxic political debate around a carbon tax. So for climate change in particular, it becomes more difficult to talk about it at the barbecue if you're worried that people are going to be against what you say. There's also been a lot of prominence of sceptical arguments in the media, despite the fact that only 7% of Australians are actually genuinely sceptical, as in they think that climate change isn't happening at all, or that it's not caused by humans in any way. So what people don't realise is that most people agree with them. So I think it's less that people don't care. I think it's more that people are not empowered to speak about it and share that they care with other people. So I think that it's really important that we consistently tell people that actually a lot of people agree with us. We're all worried about the environment. Whatever side of the political spectrum people are on, people are worried about the environment. They want to do better, and we can do it if we come together as a community.
David, can I ask you to answer a related question on that? The latest essential polling shows that, in fact, Australians are now prepared to consider direct action. So this is a new era that's upon us. What do you think it means?
So maybe let's take a step back. I mean, the former federal government and the current federal government both have accepted the science of climate change. They both have targets for emission reductions, and they're both at the same magnitude, 5% reduction in Australian greenhouse gas emissions below 2000 levels by 2020. So that's a really positive step, that this is now bipartisan support for action on climate change. The difference is how they're going to achieve it. And the former government had an emission trading scheme starting with a fixed price, and then had accepted that if the science and international action demanded it, then there would be greater emission reductions by 2020. The current government, the new government, has effectively used a rather different approach, what they call direct action, which is first of all trying what's called a reverse auction system, offering funds and people bid, offering the largest direct reductions in greenhouse gas emissions, and the money will go to effectively purchase the largest reductions currently available for the smallest amount of money. In effect, trying to directly reduce greenhouse gas emissions, it doesn't necessarily set up long-term infrastructure, and there's no necessarily long-term confidence. The other big problem with that is that the Prime Minister directly said there was no more money available. If we didn't meet the 5% emission reduction in Australia, he didn't care, despite the fact that there are international policy commitments for this 5% emission reduction to meet the Kyoto targets. So direct action has also been assessed by a range of scientists, not myself, but scientists who have looked at the capability of direct action meeting the targets, and they found that it is much more costly to use direct action as an approach to reduce greenhouse gas emissions than an emissions trading scheme, where economists and others have said that it's much more economically efficient.
To the extent that the money will be available, what purchases would you like to see in Victoria?
Well, it's clear that the least efficient, most, if you like, highest greenhouse gas emission is associated with the current brown coal electricity generators. They need to be phased out as quickly as possible.
That's top of the agenda.
Top of the agenda, because Victoria's electricity production from brown coal is worse than anywhere in Australia, and electricity production from coal in Australia is 20% worse than it is in China. It is the worst electricity generation system in terms of its carbon dioxide emissions than anywhere in the world, except the phased out electricity production system that they used to use in Ireland using peat. Yeah.
So how much will you pay for Hazelwood, David?
Well, I wouldn't pay 5 cents for it because the cost to the economy of that brown coal means that it is a zero value electricity production system. So in practice, it should be phased out by regulation. The American regulation that has just been introduced by the EPA in the United States would not allow Hazelwood to continue.
Now let me come up to the audience for some questions. Hands in the air, and we can get a microphone. I've got a hand here. Can we get a microphone just here? Thank you.
Yeah, my question is to Rob. You gave us a listing of Time magazine's 10 big problems. I'd like to add another problem and get your reaction to that, and that is extreme wealth, because it is the wealthy who are doing most to harm the environment, who are creating greenhouse gases, and who are running the corporations that basically exploit a lot of people and deplete the environment.
Oh, so I'll narrow it down and call it greed, if you like.
Yeah.
I mean, when I was an undergrad, we used to say that 20% of the world's population controls 80% of the world's resources. Today, it's 10% of the world's population controls 90% of the world's resources. I think something like the 200 biggest corporations in the world have more resources than the 50 poorest states. I mean, you're absolutely right. And there's in the climate area, there's absolutely no doubt that it's wealthy vested interests in the coal and oil sector in particular that have funded the Skeptic campaign. So I couldn't agree more.
But Rob, it's also important to understand that within Australia, because of our inefficient electricity systems, it's actually the use of these inefficient electricity systems by the average citizen, not the most wealthy in Australia, but what happens with Mr. and Mrs. Average, who are contributing disproportionately to greenhouse gas emissions. Mm. Australia has the highest per person greenhouse gas emissions of any developed country in the world, much higher than many other, you know, sort of countries, much higher than the United States, much higher than Canada. And so it is the average citizen in Australia, not just the wealthy, who are disproportionately contributing.
Yeah, quite so.
Matt, can you comment on that, on sort of how you, perhaps in terms of, what have you talked about, changing the cultural universe, this idea that individual effort does matter?
Oh, absolutely. Well, I think that the Climate Council example in the last week is a good example of that. I mean,
tell us about how that got started, by the way. I mean, you get the phone call from Greg Hunt, you're out of business.
Yeah.
And within 5 minutes you say, we're not going to take that line down. What happens?
Well, what happened was that there was a huge amount on Twitter and on Facebook and in terms of individual phone calls and emails to Tim Flannery and the other climate commissioners saying how we really valued this as a service. We think it's really important that independent science on climate change and that other experts are out there talking about this issue. And we had previously tossed around the idea, but then it really cemented, I suppose, in Tim and particularly Will Steffen's mind, that this could be a real goer. And so we looked at how you could get it off the ground, and basically the quicker the better to capitalise on people's interest. So basically we set up a really simple website with a video from Tim saying, hey, we want to keep going and we want you to get behind it. And we set up a Facebook page and a Twitter page, and we set up a donation function on the website, and we did a media conference. And that media work started to drive interest in Twitter, which drove interest in on Facebook, and then Facebook really took off. And so we started, it sort of started at 12 o'clock at night with Lateline hitting it off, and we were getting $1,000 an hour, and I thought, oh wow, that's pretty amazing. But then once we did our press conference in the morning, I checked it before the press conference, and we were at $35,000 from about 1,000 people.
I've got to ask, is it money in the bank or is it just flagged?
No, it's in the bank. Okay. So I looked, and then we did this press conference, and by the end of the day we'd raised $400,000. From from thousands of people. But I think the best news is it kept going. And usually when people do fundraising campaigns online, they use email databases, like a GetUp would use their email database. We didn't have any email database, so we had to use social media and sharing. And now we're almost at $1 million.
It's an extraordinary example of kind of citizens' action, isn't it?
Yeah, and that's 20,000 people.
People say, we value this and we will pay for it.
That's and 20,000 people took it upon themselves to spend the time to click on the thing and donate their money and get behind it. And there's also a range of other people that have supported it on Facebook and social media, because part of it, people think, oh, if you click on Facebook, there's no utility in that. Well, part of changing the cultural universe is having the conversation with people in all the mediums you have access to. So there is some power in sharing things on social media.
I guess the other thing about the public policy point is, I think there's, having had a small 4-year experience in government, you know, I think I was stunned by the amount of people in there who are intelligent, smart, trying to do good things, from ministers through to officers within bureaucracies who are doing really good work, really good policy, really intelligent stuff that's based on fantastic research, but somehow doesn't cut through, and that gets down to, again, politics and media, that narrow media prism. And so in a way, I think we've got to answer those questions before we can answer the bigger ones, the really urgent ones about climate change and so on. The thing is, for the first time it's happening. So I, like others, marched, you know, in the 70s and 80s. That's all we could do. We could get out there and get, how many people could we get walking up Swanson Street or Bourke Street? Now we can do things like this. And I think the overwhelming response shows how engaged people want to be and how much they want to do. So I guess I'd say, back to personal responsibility, we can act locally now in a really big way by engaging in that social media.
I'm going to come back out to the audience in a minute, but David, I know you wanted to say something.
I do indeed, because Amanda tells a fantastic story and it's all true. But the backstory is also really important, because what she left out was that the story she told was reaction, but it actually was anticipation. And Amanda and the other climate commissioners were very proactive. The Climate Council website and the name was reserved in advance, in anticipation, because they're not silly people. They're not naive. They are, in fact, extremely clever. And in the campaign leading up to the election, it was clear that the Climate Commission was was in real threat. Amanda was also the architect for a lot of the social media campaign, so she should take credit. Because I know Will Steffen and I know Tim Flannery, and while they're really good guys, they don't know how to drive social media, and Amanda does. So thank you, Amanda.
And of course, I'm just astonished that Amanda managed to anticipate a change of government.
Gentlemen, up the back there. Thank you.
40 years ago, there was a festival of ideas with Ehrlich and Clubber, Roman, all those sorts of things, and this is sort of directed to you, I suppose, Rob. In 40 years' time, when I'm sitting here, and keep in mind I'm a sceptical optimist, but there's a possibility, we still have that same list of 10 ideas. But the specific thing I raise in response to that last positive example of how you can change things, when are we going to really call for truth in advertising? And if we keep going in the direction of those short grabs, or whatever they're called, so we have a couple of similar ones, Stop the Boats. The other one is Stop the Tunnel. The Premier's been on radio again today talking about this road. But it's not a Labor versus Liberal thing. For 30 or 40 years, we have not dealt with how to build cities in a sustainable way. And Rob, I first met you, I think, 30 years ago. You were a bit younger than me. Have we made any progress? But more importantly, what do we have to do now in order to get beyond this Stop the Boats, Stop the Tunnel, shorthand, whatever it is, to get that commitment across government and across community?
I'll be brief, Maxine, but the media is a real problem. I spent more than 30 years working in 3 separate commercial television newsrooms. Each of the news directors that I worked with in those newsrooms was in fact a climate skeptic, because none of them understood had a fig of an idea about it. They have a blueprint. There is a blueprint for commercial television news. The ABC doesn't really adhere to it, but it adapts to it occasionally. It's a real problem. I mean, the level. Well, the first story I did on the Nella Danis, I've been going to Antarctica as a 20-year-old. I came back with a script and wrote a script straight out of university, and the sub-editor came across and said, "Now listen here, Professor, we don't write like that here." there wasn't a dictionary in the newsroom, there's certainly not an encyclopedia. There's the lack of knowledge in the place. And I actually was looking forward to going to Channel O newsroom, and I said, this would be good, coming out of university, young academic. This is a place where they're wordsmiths, you know, they really use the language. Well, believe me, they don't. And it's a fundamental problem. So I'm going to just make one more comment. I'm sort of fundamentally optimistic, and it's about some of the technologies that we have available. The other big issue is, and I mentioned it briefly, is our economic system. And I think we've got to engage in a much different way with economists as well. And it comes to the question about greed and wealth, and David's response is this business of externalized costs. Now, I've had, you know, Sol Eslake, you'll know that name. He's now the chief advisor to one of those big American banks.
USB.
Yep. And I've tried to tackle Sol a couple of times on this, and he doesn't want to go there. He really doesn't want to understand or really go into that big, broad area about what's the real cost. And I think that's what we've got to do, because if we internalise the costs, then mum and dad at home, who are burning brown coal to run their air conditioners, then they start to understand. So that distributed cost starts to work. So I think we've actually got to, I mean, if I link it back to the media to conclude, I mean, this ridiculous business we go through leading up to a federal election, where we've got, you know, radio stations across the country open up the telephone lines to people who can't balance their monthly bank card account, and they make contributions about how we should run the national economy. I mean, it's preposterous, and we let ourselves get dragged into that economics debate, and there's no difference between them anyway. We've actually, as a community, have to determine for our representatives in Parliament what the issues are. We really have to be much more progressive about doing that.
Amanda, you recommend it?
Yeah, I think that there's two solutions. I don't think, in some ways, like, I'm not going to argue for slogans, but in some ways, at least it distills the idea right down to what it's all about and makes it really clear for the public. And I think that people that are advocating for the environment need to think about distilling their concepts right down to that. Secondly, I think that we need to use the media better. The IPCC report is a really good example. People wonder, why did the IPCC report get misinterpreted? Well, number one, none of the scientists were allowed to comment on it before the report actually came out, which was last Friday. But the media commentary on it went for months beforehand. All the scientists respected the embargo. Guess who didn't respect the embargo? All of the skeptics, who then were able to lead the public narrative on the discussion of the IPCC report. You add that the highly complex nature of even the summary of the IPCC report, you can't expect the average journalist to be able to wade through that and interpret it even correctly. Something like climate sensitivity has an obvious intuitive layperson meaning, but actually has a very specific meaning in the climate science, and that was one of the concepts that got misinterpreted, whether maliciously or inadvertently. So that point is basically, whether it's scientists or whether it's others, need to use the media, how the media works, to get the outcomes that you're looking for. And the final point is to create media. So the Climate Council, for instance, now has 60,000 fans on Facebook that see what the Climate Council posts in its newsfeed. Many organisations have similar sort of followings. And that allows us to essentially have a really small media outlet. And those people, if they share the content, can help us to create that media outlet. And that's true, is there's a massive democratisation of media globally going on. And we're only very much on the cusp of what that's going to look like. So I think that creating our own media will be the next step.
I agree to that. And I just add, it is very easy for us to all ramp up our anxiety levels as we read The Australian, which I do every day. I read it because it has more news than any other newspaper, but it sort of, you know, as I say, it certainly stirs my juices. They, of course, have managed to get the op-ed piece in there today, casting doubt on the latest IPCC report and all the rest of it. But folks, the view I tend to take on this is what we're seeing is the kind of the last gasp of the great media titans. The idea that Rupert Murdoch can continue to send out his consiglieres from New York to determine the outcome of an election, this is a dying art, right? And we are certainly moving into the world that Amanda is describing. Much greater diversity of platforms. The question in my mind, of course, is that there are numerous places where you can write and get an opinion out these days. Not many of those organs are prepared to pay journalists to actually do the work but I have to believe we will get to the point where we find that next business model. But these are the problems of the extraordinary transition, it seems to me, that we're living through. I had a question here and then down here. Can we go in about another 10 minutes? Is that okay, everyone? Okay.
A lot of people in this room are probably thinking about what they can do to make an impact on the things that we're talking about. So I was wondering, for all of you, three things. One, what is the project or campaign that you've done in the past that you think has made the most impact on making progress on these issues? What are you working on now that you think has the potential to make the biggest impact? And how can the people in this room help?
Wow. Okay. David, you can lead off.
Okay, what have I done in the past? I was a major supporter of the Hepburn wind farm, both in providing advice, things like that. I think that's a wonderful community effort to provide renewable energy. What am I doing at the present? I'm trying to stop coal mining in the Galilee Basin to keep it in the ground through acting as a supporter for court cases in objections. That's keeping me busy, and I can't talk about it.
Well, Shelley,
go on, David. Is this your friend?
Shelley, what would you reply?
I think for me, it's mainly been around advocacy, but it's a kind of a narrower and broader version of sustainability for me that I want to just touch on. So it's a good excuse to pick up on that point, which is that. And it's part of, sort of follows up Amanda's comments, I think, about how we affect people or tell people what they can do. It's by empowering them. And part of that is by demonstrating how much better sustainable places are. So places is part of what I do. So demonstrating, and in my case being an advocate for, but initiating and championing affordable, sustainable, medium density housing projects, for example, through my role in previous role in government, to show that higher density developments that limit sprawl, that provide engaging, positive places that are great to be in and are 8 stars or higher, are not just more sustainable, but they're really nice, they're really good, and they actually aren't miserable. So, I mean, one of my big concerns is that the community's quite concerned about greater development for good reason, because there's been a lot of indiscriminate development. That's just because it's been done badly. We need to do it well, we can do it well, we've got the ability. So a lot of my work is around championing good design, and that's that broader sense of sustainability stuff. That's, if you have a 15-star building that's horrible, that no one wants to be in, it's not really 15-star, it'll be obsolete very quickly, it's not enduring. So part of sustainability is places that are great to be in, and that's also about infrastructure down to individual places. So that's something I have done in the past in a role with government. I continue to do it as an advocate, but also through my own projects.
One thing that I've really enjoyed doing in the last year in the Climate Commission is trying to tell the story of climate change's influence on extreme weather. So the story used to be that a scientist couldn't attribute any particular extreme weather event to climate change, and that often dominated the media story, Hurricane Sandy not related to climate change because you can't attribute a single weather event. But what the journalists often didn't hear the climate scientists say was, but let me tell you about the complexity and the way that the climate change is actually influencing extreme weather. And we did a lot of work over the last year in putting out the real story, which is that climate change is already being influenced. Extreme weather is already being influenced by climate change, particularly in Australia. And we've just gone, the last month was the hottest September on record. We've had a record-breaking year with roughly more than 500 records broken around the country.
And bushfires already in New South Wales.
Absolutely. And you might remember the summer. We described it as the angry summer because there's just so many records broken in heat around Australia. So I think that story has been really important, not just to tell it in the public, in the media, but also to tell it to the particular groups who find it really important to know, because they need to prepare for it. So emergency services, health workers, nurses, etc., etc., local governments that need to be preparing for the changes that will inevitably happen, as well as mitigating from greater change. In terms of question 2 and 3, I'm obviously working on the Climate Council, and I'd love you to all get involved by joining our Facebook page and sharing our content and becoming reporters in your own right to tell all of your friends and family about it. And if you're inclined also to donate to the effort, what we hope to do, we've already got 20,000 people behind it to get it off the ground, and we hope to be able to just keep going with the community funding, calling it crowdfunded science information.
Yeah.
Rob.
Hi, Anna. My success story is one that I can thank Rupert Murdoch for. Rupert Murdoch owned Channel 10 for 3 years back in about 1986, 87, 88. And I was invited by the newsroom at Channel 10 to take a 6-week trip to Antarctica. I think they thought I was going to go down and come back with some stories to say it's cold down there. Because I was doing the weather on the telly. Unbeknownst to them, I was actually talking to some people at the Australian Conservation Foundation, and I was aware that there was a global campaign by Northern Hemisphere nations to open up Antarctica for minerals and oil exploration called the Cranmer Agreement, Convention for the Regulation of Antarctic Minerals and Energy. So a lot of the stuff that... So I went down for 6 weeks on a ship on the Icebird with a cameraman and a sound assistant. Was wonderful. It was at a time when Barry Jones was the federal minister. Australia was trying to demonstrate it had a legitimate claim to our 42% claim to Antarctica. Nobody owns land, we just claim territory. And we were flying little plastic fiberglass igloos and things around, dropping them on the snow and ice out of helicopters so Barry could put another flag on the map so he could say, look at the presence that Australia has in Antarctica. So that was the reason that there was an ABC FM radio station. Gillian Triggs, who's now the commissioner for internet, she just written a book, a PhD thesis on international law and the sea as it applies to Antarctica. We had a Russian-speaking foreign affairs interpreter. We did an official inspection of Mirny. It was a Swedish geomorphologist, a Japanese geophysicist, a Spanish ornithologist, and I've forgotten a few others. But this was the PR trip. Now, what that did, it gave me an opportunity to put 2 weeks of special reports on Channel 10 News about a whole range of issues other than the fact that it's cold down there. And it got me back involved with the ACF and got me back involved with the environmental movement and back to where things I'd learned at university. What am I doing today? Well, there's social media, but there's also mobile media. So I'm a principal of a business that uses these things. This is a television station in your pocket, folks. So during the last federal election, we were sending out video messages from Adam Bandt on the back of an SMS to thousands of people at a time, and that's how you use the stuff that Amanda's doing in people's hands.
Terrific. Okay, we're going to take a question down here.
Thank you very much. I think what you've done is to really epitomise for me what this whole festival is about. And it's about having a debate about how we try and get the science to make a difference. How can we, in our current state of democracy? So this is going to segue beautifully into our Sunday debate about whether democracy is failing us to solve the wicked problems that face us as a society. And my sense is, and the thing that the anguish that drove me in planning this whole festival was, we do this science, we have a lot of knowledge, we even have a lot of wisdom. How in the hell do we get it into where it's going to make a difference for all of us in society? I'm not convinced we can have a public debate. I don't know what a public debate actually is when you've got these really difficult, complex problems. I mean, for every complex problem, there's a simple solution and it's always wrong. So I want to actually ask you about how... I'm also interested in the relationship between scientists, journalists, science and the media, and how we get the messages out. I happen to be chairing a panel for the ABC, which I asked them to set up, which is looking at the quality of science broadcasting. And I think that's really worrying for us that we don't have enough science journalists, enough specialist journalists anymore. So it doesn't matter how you get the message out, guys, we've got to have good people doing the copy. You can get it out on social media, you can get it out on the traditional print media or on television and onto your iPhones, but the quality of that. So where are the quality scientists who can do journalism and the journalists who can do science? And it's that sort of interface that I'm interested in and how we're going to do that, because it seems to me that's crucial. So we've got to have more of the Jonica newbies prancing around looking absolutely gorgeous and doing just what Amanda said, looking at the extremes and making it somehow sexy and scary at the same time. So I think, you know, if we're going to have a public debate about this stuff, so I'm anxious about that, but I'm also inspired by all of you thinking that in fact we're going to make this debate happen. So how do we solve this problem about science and the media and getting the really, really crucial arguments across to a public who are increasingly distrustful of science and dismissive of it because we've been undermined by people who don't want to believe this science because they're making such a buck out of it?
Well, perhaps in the first instance, a Minister for Science who could articulately speak about the value of science.
I'll make a very quick response to this. One very practical and superb addition to public discourse has actually come out of the universities, and it's called The Conversation.
Yep.
And what The Conversation does is to connect academic expertise with mainstream journalism. And because we've seen so much hollowing out in traditional media, particularly at Fairfax, more and more items in The Conversation are being picked up by other outlets. So that's very good. But I will say this, it is easy to flick off at the politicians, easy to flick off at journalists. My plea to those in the academy, as we're here at a university event, don't go missing in action. It is too easy for those in the academy to retreat, to say it is too bruising out there on the playground, so we won't say anything. We go out there and we'll get beaten up by Andrew Bolt. Well, sorry. You gotta get involved. You gotta get engaged. David, your turn.
Well, and credit to David, he does. He does.
So, I don't think I've ever been described as a shrinking violet. And
you know what I'm talking about.
Absolutely. And so, I think there are a number of ways to answer the question, and I think it is critically important. First of all, that universities provide appropriate experience and training for early career researchers to get the experience in a friendly environment. Almost 99% of my experiences in the media have been very well handled by the media, and they present the information as accurately as possible. However, specifically in the field in which I work, in climate change, there have been a small number of experiences, and not for me, because I'm perceived now to be, in some sense, armor-clad and, you know, indestructible. The targets that are used are particularly younger academics, younger scientists. There is a wonderful book by Mike Mann who talks about the approaches that are used, which is, in some sense, named the Serengeti principle, which is that the predators attack the weakest part of the herd. And the weakest part of the herd is the people on the fringe. The people on the fringe are the youngest early career scientists who are often engaged by the media because they're still doing exciting research and they're still able to present it in ways that's accessible, very much accessible. There is certainly a research fellow who's worked with me who has had a very difficult time in the last 12 months by being attacked in social media, by being attacked in emails, by people who absolutely know nothing about the science but have harassed her endlessly for more than 12 months. And that approach, fortunately, the University of Melbourne has sought to provide as much protection as possible. But she was going to give up as a scientist. And what I hate about that is the way that emails, social media seem to give a license to anyone to express their opinion vehemently and strongly. And yet, that's not what, in effect, is the best way to get the best information. So I understand what is happening. I also understand that many scientists working in government agencies have a very tight rein put on them in communicating to the newspapers, communicating in the media, and there's a relatively small number of climate scientists working in universities who are given access. There is no department of atmospheric science or climate science in any Australian university. And that's for historical reasons. There's a very small number of climate scientists. Fortunately, there hasn't been no cloning of David Karoly. We wouldn't want it, but I've certainly heard that having more climate scientists available to communicate in this area would be advantageous. We want a wider number of voices. And again, the Climate Commission set up a wonderful training program in the last 6 months to give climate scientists, early career scientists, the opportunity to get training in this. And this is a wonderful way that, again, the Climate Commission, the now ex-Climate Commission, used its resources to effectively build a greater pool of climate scientists.
Yes, please.
Sure. I mean, as a non-scientist, I think one of the things that we need to do is to make the link between science, so science and journalism, yes, but science and all of the other, I mean, that's one of the problems we've had in the past. It's the root of many of the issues that we're dealing with is that we don't collaborate. We haven't worked in an interconnected way that's fundamental to good, to sustainable practice. But I think making the link between the scientists and the non-scientists, and that's through stories and through collaborations with others. And I guess I'm also thinking of, I learned about Henry VIII and his six wives, and that's all I can remember from my history lessons at school. But I just read Hilary Mantel's second book about Henry VIII's wives, and my mind is full of this incredible richness, and the story is so compelling. I'm not just talking about fiction. I think fiction and music and all of those cultural events are relevant, but the collaboration between scientists and others, and I guess back to architecture, back to the household users, two of the biggest drains on household energy are plasma TVs and air conditioning. Mm. If people see that you don't need air conditioning in Victoria, you just do not need it. It's not required. It's not necessary. So many people are clients of mine who are committed to sustainability, but we really need to have aircon just for those 7 hot days in February. And I couldn't argue them around. That's pretty devastating. They need to see alternatives and to feel that a sustainable house is a whole lot better. It's a whole lot cheaper, and it has a massive impact on reducing our energy consumption. So.
And Amanda, I'm going to give the final word to you.
Yeah, well, going back to the Fiona's question around the media and science, I think that there's my advice for scientists and other experts is firstly to go out together. I think that when you have one head above the parapet, it's easy for it to get shot off. But when you've got a whole bunch of experts saying, hey, this is the case, I think that's really important in climate change for many people to come out and often at a similar time and say, no, this is the truth and this is where we're going, and this is where we need to be and all those sorts of things. Secondly, I think, as David said, training is really important, but not just for early career scientists, particularly for later career scientists, particularly for people that are experts in the media. Anyone that's speaking in the media should get regular training, I think, and should be thinking carefully about what the message is and how they can get their ideas out there in the best way. And one of the best ways, I think, is to work on the communications from the beginning to the end. Often communications come in right at the end. I'll write a press release about this complex thing that we've just written and we want to put it out tomorrow and it's a Friday afternoon, when that's clearly going to be the worst possible time for the media. And also the poor comms person who's trying to decipher what this thing is about can't work it out and writes a terrible press release and then no one reports about it, except maybe the conversation, which is great because the conversation is fantastic, except that most of middle Australia don't read it, unless, as you say, it's picked up by other journalists. So I think that we need to be in the conversation, but we need to be in all the other forms of media too, which means putting comms. If you want to communicate, you've got to have it from the beginning. You've got to be trained so that you're able to get your message out clearly and you're not stumped. And then the most important thing is to never read Andrew Bolt and to never read the comments. If you read the comments in your opinion piece, you'll only be very sad. So it's either get...
you need to know thy enemy.
Yes.
Or you just get your friends to comment. If I was publishing an article, I would get all of my friends to comment first. And because there's a whole lot of paid trolls and things out there, particularly around the climate science. You would know this, David.
This lady is clearly practiced in the new dark arts.
Yes. So, yes, don't read Andrew Bolt, don't read the comments, and you'll feel a lot better.
Actually, Rob, given that you gave us an outstanding presentation this evening, the last word really should go to you. Do you want to bring a few comments together?
Look, I think you can learn those things, and yeah. I think it's, we've just moved into a new age of communication, and I think it's very important that we all do that. I think that I've had the opportunity to facilitate, I think, 3 of the Climate Commission conversations with the community. So I want to pick up on the really valuable part of it that Amanda mentioned. Apart from Tim Flannery and Will Steffen and Leslie Hughes, Roger Beale and
Jerry Houston,
and now
Venus
Ajuala from University of New South Wales. There's a wonderful balance there. So this going out as a group, and having the former president of BP sitting alongside the scientists saying, no, I understand what they're saying. We were saying this, John Brown was saying this back in 1990. we haven't got a problem with this. It's about where the opportunity is. You know, you got to architect this. You got to design it. You can't expect to be effective in a world where communications is so broad as it is, unless you really got your act together. So it is, and you can learn it. And you can learn it very positively. And there's new things coming up. The conversation's a particularly good example, but we do need to all skill ourselves. You know, go to the United States. Any American person, I reckon, can be interviewed on television. They sound fantastic. They don't all sound fantastic. But, you know, any college kid in the States can hold a good conversation. I don't think that we do that very well in Australia. I don't think we stand up and speak our mind. I think we actually need to learn to do that. We need to communicate strongly, be very clear on what our messages are.
Okay. Look, ladies and gentlemen, we have run over time, but I'm sure you'll agree we've traversed a lot of ground, but at the same time, perhaps only touched the sides. But I hope you felt stimulated, perhaps unsettled in some good ways. Would you please show your appreciation for our panellists tonight?